I think it's connected to human nature, that we want to know who we are, we want to know where we're coming from, we want to know what is around us, we want to have these answers. We take a piece of a clockwork, as I used to do when I was a child, and you break it apart and you try to figure out how does it work. That's essentially what's happening in high energy physics.
And so we can unveil the mystery of the universe. Accelerator is a double-faced machine. On one side is a super microscope, is capable to unveil the mystery of the universe at the very little teeny detail. We are talking about 1/1,000,000,000,000 of a meter. It's also a time machine, because it brings back to the origin of the universe, because it recreates conditions that existed only a few milliseconds, few microseconds after the Big Bang.
We want to understand how the universe got to be the way it is today, where the matter in the universe comes from, what is the dark matter that holds all the galaxies together.
We can look at the detail of the infinitely small, but by looking at that, in reality, we're going to be able to answer questions about the universe or something infinitely big.
You know, incredible as it is, the Higgs boson is playing our mass, but meanwhile, our colleague, the other fundamental discipline, which is cosmology or astrophysics, they discovered that the mass explained by the Higgs boson is only 5% of the universe.
There's all this other stuff that we still have to try to understand. There's much more dark matter out there than visible matter, and even beyond dark matter, there's also dark energy.
Very many fundamental questions, the origin of the universe and so on and so forth, which we are trying to understand with the LHC.
So you're looking at the LHC machine behind me, and you actually see probably the magnets as they curve into the tunnel.
The LHC, even if it's a young accelerator, is however becoming old.
And we are now on the way of reaching the highest energy for which the machine has been designed.
In science and in physics, we are pretty much like in society. We want to improve our return on investment. And the investment for LHC has been massive. And what interests the physicists and the community is to have much more collisions, much more statistics in a shorter period of time.
We want to increase the rate at which we produce physics. And that's the upgrade of the Large Hadron Collider.
Well, the plan is, first of all, to run the LHC for about 10 years, up to 2025, with increasing performance. And then to do a big step. And this big step is the project I'm leading, which is called High Luminosity LHC.
The one part is the upgrade of the machine itself. And on the other part, you have the detectors that they have to adapt and improve their electronics, improve their sub-detector systems, so that they can read out more data that they are provided from the collider.
So the High Lumi project will enable us to get a lot more out of the LHC than we've been able to get so far.
This basically means increase possibility for new discoveries.
It's going to enable us to probe much deeper into the history of the universe, look at very rare processes, and study particle physics in much more detail than regular LHC.
Why it is called High Luminosity LHC? But we said before that the accelerator, the collider, is like a microscope. To see better, you need more light.
Lumi, to a physicist, means luminosity. That's the number of collisions we can make per day. And High Lumi, well, that just means lots more collisions per day.
We will increase by a factor 10 the number of collisions produced by LHC, which is a lot. It's like to be in this room and instead to be illuminated by a bulb of 100 watts, very suddenly you turn on a bulb of 1,000 watts, 1 kilowatt. You have a lot of light. You see much better, provided that your eyes are adapted. That's why it's not enough to increase the light, high luminosity LHC. You need also to adapt the detector of the machine.
So the higher the energy, the smaller the size of the particle you can examine and look at. Now, something as big as our world, you can examine with our own eyes. To go smaller in scale, you need microscopes. And when you go smaller and smaller in scale, eventually you need accelerators.
And they are colliding, these two beams of protons. Every place that they collide, you have to build something around it, like a camera, where you would see what happened in this collision. And one of these places, one out of the four, it's the CMS detector.
you always have to find the delicate equilibrium between pushing the limits but not too much, because if you push too much, then you think about devices that cannot be built.
It's like to take a car, let me say a Ferrari, that goes 400 km per hour, and now you want to have a Ferrari that goes 600 km per hour. Clearly, you have to change completely.
Here, the 27 km long tunnel of the RIC, and divided in 8 points. Of the 8 points, we will upgrade mainly, but not only, the 2 points where is Atlas, point one, and CMS, point five. We will have heavy civil engineer work, you see it in red, with the new construction, but also we will upgrade, of course, the LAC tunnel with a lot of technical new equipment, magnets, craft cavity, and so on and so on. But we will upgrade also point four, where there is the radio frequency, the system that accelerates the beam. We will upgrade the cryogenics there, and we will upgrade also other points, very important in point seven, in point eight, in point two, and so on. Only point three is not concerned. So you see, we will do a lot of deal around the LAC.
To increase the number of collisions, what we are trying to do is actually to focus more this cloud of particles. Basically, if this cloud is smaller, more compressed, we increase the probability of having collision between these two clouds.
We need to work on some of the magnets that we have in the machine, changing them, changing the technology, in particular the material which is in the magnets.
In practice, we change 1.2 kilometers of the accelerator out of the 27. For the upgrade of the LAC, the key components are focusing magnet, what we call quadrupole. We have also dipole magnet that we call dipole 11 Tesla. We have a special object that we call superconducting crab cavity. The most important element is certainly the focusing quadrupole.
We have two types of superconducting magnet. We have several types, but the most important one are dipole and quadrupole.
A dipole is a magnet that gives a constant magnetic field all over an aperture. A quadrupole, on the other hand, is a magnet that gives zero field in the center and an increasing field when you go out of the aperture. So the dipole essentially is used to bend the particles. It's like when you are in the highway and you take an exit, so you must put some force to make the car bending. You are not changing the velocity, but you are changing the direction of the velocity. So the force of the steering wheel is the magnetic field. If you have more force, you can make a shorter accelerator.
The quadrupole instead are the superconducting magnets that focus the beam.
What we need to do is to blow them up further and then focus them to much smaller size, about 5 microns in size, say, so that the rate of production of energy events is higher. And we do that by changing some of these magnets, which are made with an alloy of niobium and titanium, with a new material, which is a composite of niobium and tin.
Since this particle have a very high energy, we need a very high magnetic field. In order to achieve very high magnetic field, we use superconductors.
But the superconductor is the heart, in any sense, is the heart of the LAC, is the heart of a luminosity LAC. The main technology are superconducting technology. Superconductivity is a fascinating phenomenon.
A superconductor, which basically means it's a conductor, a metal is a conductor of what? Of current. Super, which means that it's able to transfer current without dissipating energy.
To increase the field from the current 8 Tesla in the LAC to the 11, 20 Tesla that we need to have in the Illumi LAC, we had to change the superconducting material. Right now in the LAC we are using niobium titanium, which is a superconducting material that allows us to get up to 8, 9 Tesla. In order to achieve 11, 12 Tesla, we need a new type of superconductor material, which is niobium 13.
We need superconductivity, but alas, as the French say, is a difficult technology.
Well, we are in the superconducting laboratory of the T department at CERN. For high luminosity LAC, we will produce both the niobium 13 and the niobium tie cable in this laboratory.
Okay, this is the cabling machine.
We have 40 spools which rotate. Each of these spools contains typically a couple of kilometers of wire. The wires are twisted in order to obtain a round configuration. And then when the machine is running, it goes inside a torque head where this round configuration is compressed. And as a result of this compression, we get this flat cable which has a typical trapezoidal shape. They are the heart of the magnet. A magnet can never behave better than the superconductor it is made of. So a single wire, single superconductor, cannot transfer so much current, so we have to put many wires together in order to be able to transfer more current. We have 40 niobium-13 wires reduced to this rectangular shape in order to get the maximum compaction. And this is what we use for making magnets. So basically, if you look at the cross-section of an LAC dipole magnet, you can see the two beam pipes. And just around the two beam pipes, you can see these very small cables, which are those who transfer very high currents. And these cables are the ones which produce the magnetic field, which in the case of a dipole, drives the beam around the circumference of the accelerator. These cables is able of carry typically about 20,000 amps. The present high voltage cable do not transfer such an high current. When you deal with copper, the copper warms up, and even in applications like high voltage cables, you never transfer more than about 2,000 amps. Here are 20,000, so 10 times more. So this kind of current you can transfer only with superconductors.
In certain material, they can bring electrical current without resistance. Incredible. It's the dream of everybody of us. No pain, electric bill.
If these materials are so fantastic, why we do not use them in the everyday life? And the key answer to that is that you need to generate very low temperatures, which basically means that you need to have a closed cryogenic envelope which maintains the cold and enable the line to operate at temperature where it is superconducting.
Basically, what we do, we build a coil with the superconducting cable. The coil is the key component of the magnet, is the component that creates the field.
We are making magnetic fields that are a bit less than half a million larger than the magnetic field of the Earth.
Creating superconducting magnets is not easy, and then it requires quite a bit of time. Usually, we start with the design of the superconducting magnets performing computation because we want to produce a certain field in a certain area. That requires a lot of design work. Then we start fabricating small model of the final magnet to test if the parameters are correct. And only after that, we start building the full size magnet, which is an object of about 1 meter diameter and 10-15 meter length. So this process can take up to 15-20 years.
Actually, most of it is done on site today, and we are profiting from a collaboration with our US colleagues. They started this development years ago while we were finishing the LHC.
We have two types of facility to produce magnet. One, a small laboratory where we produce the conceptual, so the small magnet, 1 meter long, something like this. We call magnet lab facility. And then we have a large magnet facility where we can build long magnet.
So this is building 180 in the CERT terminology. The Atlas magnet has been assembled here, the Atlas experiment itself, for the LEC, and now is taken by the magnet of the LEC and for high luminosity LEC. So you see, this is one of the best workshops at CERN, but probably the largest workshop at CERN, all dedicated to the superconducting magnet.
So this is one of the LHC main dipole magnets. We see the outside envelope, which is cryostat, the inside, which is actually the core of the magnet. That's the magnet itself. We call it the cold mass assembly. For winding the coils, we need a clean environment. These machines, they are winding machines. They are the machines that we need to make the coil from the cable. This is a piece of cable. You can see that the gantry can move from one end to the other end of the machine. For the LAC magnets, the coil, which is made of two layers, inner layer, outer layer, they are wound of this type of machine, of this winding mandrel. They are wound separate, and there's a splice in between the two. For the HL-LHC magnets, we cannot produce a splice in between the layers, so the two layers are wound from the same cable unit length, and there's no splice.
This is actually one of the first coils in IRB13 ever produced at CERN for the quadrupole. This is the heart of the upgrade. This is the heart of high luminosity LEC.
This is one of the new types of magnets for the high luminosity LEC project. This coil is a quadrupole coil which is completely finished. After winding, it needs to go to reaction process. And the reaction process is a heat treatment up to 650 degrees for about 2 weeks. So it's a very long process.
And if you can see in the back, the big oven where this famous reaction, 650 Celsius, is done. It has very controlled temperature. You can imagine that the accuracy in temperature is within 100,000 part, 1 degree out of 100,000 part.
After curing, after a reaction, we need to impregnate the coil. So this yellow machine is a vacuum pressure impregnation machine. That is the machine that is used to impregnate the coils after the reaction process, and that will constitute the electrical insulation system for the coil. Impregnation, it needs to go from top to bottom, and for that reason we need to tilt the chamber, and this is how it comes after impregnation. And actually, you can see here in the ends of the coil, the turns, the end regions, the cable, how it's fitted around the end spaces.
We generate a much higher magnetic field. The forces are huge. It's like a car. You need to have a stability of the car much higher. Otherwise, the car simply will go out at the first bend.
So this is a prototype of the 11 Tesla dipole magnet for the high luminosity LHC project. What we see here in the end, we can see the two coils, poles. There's an upper lower pole. The assembly is here turned 90 degrees for the measurement. And around the coils, we see the collars. The collars are mechanical structure for the coils. And here in the middle, the pipe in which the particles will circulate. There will be two of these colored coils put together, one on top of the other, and there will be the same yoke turned 180 degrees covering the whole assembly, and that will constitute the main part of the magnet. So next, this will go in what we call a welding press.
At the end, the superconductor is the heart, but the mechanical structure, like the skeleton, is the one that really sustains the force of the body.
So this is what we call a welding press. The magnet will be put in cradles on this very thick beam. It goes in the press. In the press, it will be given a curvature. So the magnets are 16 meters in length, but they have to be curved in the horizontal plane. And the curvature is 9 millimeters over the 16 meters. So it's very small over the entire length of the magnet. So at some point, this assembly will finish in a cold mass assembly like this one, and there will be two of these magnets in one single structure like this one, and the beams will circulate in pipes, in this pipe, in opposite direction.
So let's understand how we can have our 11 Tesla dipole starting from the LAC main dipole that you have today. The LAC main dipole has a twin collar and it completely linked the two coils. In the case of 11 Tesla, the collar will be separated because this is much stronger structure that helps to keep the forces. And the forces are higher because here the coil is transformed with many more coils, many more cables.
such a way that we can increase more field. Same current in each cable, but more cable brings more field. And more field means more forces and more stored energy. So these new colors will help to keep the stronger forces of the 11 Tesla dipole. And in this way, we can reach our scope of high luminosity LEC.
Every time this cloud of protons, which contain about 100 billion protons, collide, they produce about 40 collisions.
Today in LEC they do not collide at on the beam. So we lose a little bit, but in LEC we don't lose that much. In high lumi we will lose a lot.
So the two key components we expect to do the job of this luminosity upgrades are the high field magnets, and then the second very important technology will be the crab cavities.
So crab cavities are RF equipment that will so-called crab the bunch of the particles. So the particles, they collide at the interaction point with an angle, and the overlap of the two bunches, it's smaller than if they were colliding face to face. So this is really a pioneering technology. It has been proposed for the LHC by Rama Kalaga.
If you had a crossing angle, obviously one bunch would only see a part of the other bunch, while with the crab cavities, by tilting them into the collision point, you maximize so that they really traverse through each other, so that they will maximize the probability and hence the luminosity.
The crab cavities, first of all, it's our equipment that have never been done before, the shape that we are doing. They are new development, fully new development.
The crab cavities that we are using today are made of bulk niobium. This material at 2 Kelvin exhibits superconducting properties, which is extremely favorable to sustain the type of very high fields that we would like to generate inside the cavity. The crab cavities create effectively a transverse field that are oscillating at 400 megahertz. That is effectively every 2.5 nanoseconds they change the direction of the field to go up and down. And the bunches that in the LHC pass by every 25 nanoseconds. As the particles pass through, they usually have a finite length. In the LHC, this length is about 7 centimeters, so it's a macroscopic length. And when it passes through this cavity, each particle in the bunch can be kicked with respect to the radio frequency wave. So we can choose how the bunches are rotated with respect to the center of the bunch.
The beam goes very fast, goes at the speed of the light. So a beam which is kind of typically 10 centimeter long, or a little bit longer, 15 centimeter long, it passes in front of me in 1 billionth of a second. 1 billionth of a second, no time to look at it. And the crab cavity must grasp this beam and must rotate and give it the right angle. And especially, even more amazing, 400 meter aside, another crab cavity must give a counter shot, let's put it this way, exactly equal and opposite, exactly, otherwise the beam will not be stable.
Cryogenics is a word to describe very low temperature. It is when you are minus 120 or so. But temperature can go down to minus 273. And practically for these magnets, we go down to minus 271. We are at 2 degrees with respect to absolute zero. It's a fantastic adventure to the cold world. The universe is considered to be cold at about 3 to 4 degrees from absolute zero. So we go cooler than the universe. So in order to go down to this temperature, we need a fluid which does not solidify when you cool it down. Water would solidify at zero and then you cannot do anything else. There's only helium that can still be liquid at this very low temperature. And here it is the magnet itself with the interconnection. Helium is along the superconductor here and filling inside all this cold mass, but this is static. And we profit from the very nice performance of helium being superfluid. In the LHC, we have a total inventory of 130 tons of helium, out of which about 100 tons of helium is stored static in the magnets. Going to high lumi will not change the inventory, so the power density, let's say, are much bigger for high lumi than they are for LHC. So the magnets will be more powerful in order to have the beam more compact and to have more statistics. But otherwise, it is quite similar. So the challenge for us will be to manufacture these machines and to be able to operate them in 10 years from now with the same level of availability than the present 8 ones that have been built 15 years ago. In order to produce coal, you need to expand. Everybody has tested with a pump for a bicycle that when you compress, it heats up in your hands. So compressing means heating, expanding means cooling. We are in front of our compressor station. This is very noisy, 110 decibels, and this is our source of pressure. So here we are in front of one of the 8 helium liquefiers from the LHC. And for Hailumi, we will need 2 machines similar to this one. A liquefier works with a combination of compressor and expansion. And in front of us, we have here some of the expanders used in this process for helium. So all this allows to liquefy helium. And this helium is after transported into the line above our head, which goes down 100 meters below ground level. So as a kind of general rule, we don't dare to bring down this kind of very important piece of equipment in a tunnel 100 meters below ground without testing it completely at the surface.
You will never drive a Formula One car if it's not been properly tested. So a very important facility is where we test the magnet. And no, magnet not tested is no value. So we need to test the magnet in the real condition, like in the accelerator. We need to have the same system that we have done 100 meters underground in the accelerator. This building is called SM18.
And what you have here is just a test facility where we qualify and test all these equipments to make sure that they are 100% to spec and performance before we bring them and start to connect them in series in the tunnel. What we have here is the test station for the magnets. On the top we have the sieve tubes which distribute the helium to the different benches, and helium flows down to the magnets and cool the magnets in about 3 days. About 1 gram per second is needed for one of these magnets, so it's a very small flow of helium that is flowing there, and inside this cools with a heat exchanger all this entire mass. It's about 15 tons of mass, which is cooled by this little flow of helium.
There is a lot of instrumentation in the magnet that we attach to the different points of the magnet in order to monitor temperature, to monitor the field that we produce, the current that we put. Clearly, normally what we see, the magnet is not perfect. We will see some problem. So we feed back in the design, we change the shape of some parts, we change a little bit the fabrication process, we rebuild another Scholl model, we come here, we retest. Normally the magnet is better, and then we can proceed with the development of the long models.
A teeny error in the magnet and you will lose a magnet. A magnet of the Hailumi, they cost typically 5 million per magnet. 5 million, it means that a teeny error, you lose this. You lose this and you lose 2 years to build it. So that's why you need a really global quality. Global quality means to have severe protocol to test.
And that is the most exciting moment, because basically in 1 day you have the answer about the quality of what you have done. So clearly there is a lot of excitement during the testing of the magnet.
Well, integration, as I always say, is the realm, is the range of complexity. It's not a technical difficulty. Technical difficulty is to build the magnet, to manufacture the superconductor. But integration is the realm of complexity, because you have to fit all together.
So the Hailumi project has 2 parts. It's in the 0.1 and the 0.5. 2 package, they are identical. We have an underground part and a surface part.
We have 2 construction sites, one at 0.5 in France and one at 0.1 in Switzerland. This is the Swiss site. We're going to build 5 surface structures, an electrical building, then also a ventilation building, the SD building, which gives access to the shaft, a building to house compressors, and a cooling tower.
We have a shaft to be constructed, 80 meters deep, 10 meters of diameter. We have a cavern, 50 meters long and 16 meters of diameter. We have a gallery, 500 meters long, and some perpendicular other service galleries connecting the Hailumi with the existing LHC.
Sensitivity of the LHC to vibrations is very high. If earthquakes happen on the other part of the world, vibrations of those earthquakes are seen in the LHC. So actually digging large diameter shafts and new caverns in such proximity to a very sensitive experiment is special and is in a way challenging and interesting. Research we've been doing kind of revealed that if we're digging and excavating using a diesel-powered excavator, there is a very high risk that the machine will suffer from vibration influence, because the LHC machine has a vibrational frequency, a natural frequency, which is kind of triggered by such a diesel engine. And so the specifications towards the contractor request the use of electric excavators.
The works will start in 2018, in April, and they will last 5 years.
In April 18, the contractors are mobilizing on site. They're first starting with the excavation of the shaft. And by the end of 18, we should have reached the bottom level of the shaft, where the shaft feeds into the cavern.
You start a project with a small line in a paper, and you finish with a big cavern full of detectors, equipment, etc., etc. It's very, 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 very satisfactory for me.
We will see the results only in 10-15 years from now, but every day there is a small achievement towards that goal that makes the everyday life very exciting.
The feeling to do something important, something challenging. We know that we are doing something new, that we remain. The next accelerator after iLumi will use iLumi technology, that is for sure.
The lots more collisions that we're going to get from high iLumi LHC will enable us to explore all sorts of rare processes that we're not able to study properly with LHC as it is now. Will the Higgs boson reveal some secret beyond the standard model that describes all the visible matter in the universe? Maybe iLumi will reveal dark matter. I don't know, I'm excited to find out. But I think we're going to have to need to be smarter, quicker, cleverer with iLumi data.
In the society today, we are getting more and more focused on the short term. At CERN, we are making an investment on long term. So it's like the cathedrals of the Middle Ages. People start and then the song continues and then the grand song. We can work together also, not only across borders, but also across time.
Of course, you're always afraid, you know, something may fail. I may not make it. But that's actually why we are trying to do that. We're pushing those boundaries. We keep in our mind that our mission is to produce physics, and the technology goes with it. We're trying to do something which hasn't been done before, so it's a great feeling in that respect.
Exciting. It is really challenging sometimes. It's a place where we have a wealth of intellects around us with tons of knowledge around, where I'm able to go next door and discuss about some complex thing, and then we're able to implement some new idea discussed over coffee yesterday and actually test it and see that it works. It's great.
During the summer, CERN is full of students that come from all over the world. Sometimes they barely understand each other, but they understand each other with science.
We are all here to answer to a fundamental question that we have in ourselves. The question for more, what we are made of, where we come from.
But it's important to have a tool like this because it will allow us to see things that up to now we have not seen.
We are like the people that are building up the ship with which Christophorus Columbus will discover America. No ships, no new land.